So in this video, we have to understand about the poles and the zeros concept in the transfer function. So the first point is you will have the transfer function as numerator by denominator. You have studied two types we had, improper and proper, correct? So let us take the proper transfer function. This means that denominator degree will always be highest than the numerator degree. Now you have to represent this transfer function as s minus z1, s minus z2, and so on. How many terms you have in that equation, but you have to represent in that manner, and the denominator you have to represent as s minus p1, s minus p2, s minus p3, and so on. Why I am doing this? Because now if you equate numerator is equal to 0, you will get the zeros of the transfer function, and if you put denominator is equal to 0, you will get poles of the transfer function. So basically you will get z1, z2, z3, all the zeros of the transfer function, and all the poles p1, p2, p3, and so on. Once you get that, the next task is to plot them. So the representation is this for the zeros and the representation is this for the poles. Suppose I have this graph where x-axis is the real part and the y-axis is the imaginary part. So let's say my z1 is 1 and p1 is minus 1. So somewhere 1 is present here, somewhere minus 1 is present here in the axis. Okay, so I got that, but how to represent the zeros? So at 1 you have to place one circle. This means 0 is at 1. And if you put a cross, this means pole is at minus 1. So pole is at minus 1. This is 0. So this was the basic explanation of a transfer function pole zero concept. First you have to represent the transfer function in this given way, then you have to find the zeros and the poles of that transfer function, and then you have to plot that. So let's see this example, or else pause this video and try to solve this. So let's solve this question. If you solve that question correctly, congrats, but if you fail to solve that, let's do it step by step. The first point is I have to represent this transfer function in the given manner. In the previous slide we have seen that, so it can be represented as 3 minus s 3s minus 1 would be a no problem, a single bracket we have, and s square plus 3s plus 2 can be represented as s plus 2 into s plus 1, correct? That is nothing but the normal first step, but now we have to go for the plot, and then we can also comment on the stability. So we have to watch this video further to understand about the stability concept. So first I am putting numerator is equal to 0, so I will get 3s minus 1 is equal to 0. This means s is equal to 1 by 3. If I put denominator is equal to 0, I will get s plus 2 into s plus 1 is equal to 0. This means that s is equal to minus 2 and minus 1. This can be represented as our 0 is at 1 by 3 and our pole 1 is at minus 2 and pole 2 is at minus 1. Now you have to plot that. So that is the second point you have to plot. In the x-axis you have the real part, in the y-axis you have the imaginary part. So your 0 is at 1 by 3, so this is, let's say, 1 by 3. Your pole is at minus 1 and minus 2. So this is the pole 0 plot. Whenever you see this kind of question in your academic paper, the pole 0 plot, you have to plot this. And you have understood the steps. So these are the steps. First step and the second step. And you will get the answer. But now comes the third point. What if they ask whether this system is stable? Then how you can solve that? By looking at this graph, you can tell whether this system is stable or not. The concept is very simple. This system is stable when all poles are in left hand side or left half of the plane only. This word only is very important. Now you can see in this transfer function all the poles were in the left hand side of the plane, whereas this is the right hand side of the plane. If the pole is present here in the right hand side anywhere, then the system is unstable. But as you can see, our system is present in the left half of the plane. You can say that our system is stable. So I hope you got that, because the final reason I will give you, all the poles minus 2 and minus 1 were in the left half of the plane, and that's why you can say that our system is stable. If it was plus 1, then the system would be unstable, or plus 2 or anything. But if it would be 0, then it is marginally stable because it is at the margin, this line, correct? So it was marginally stable. So let's solve this question, example of poles and zeros. A system has poles at s is equal to minus 3 and s is equal to minus 2 and the zeros are at s is equal to minus 1. Draw the pole zero plot and write the transfer function. Very simple question. Basically, you have to draw a pole zero plot. So x-axis is the real part. So real part, y-axis is the imaginary part. And you have to plot the poles and the zeros. So 0 is at minus 1, pole 1 is at minus 2, pole 2 is at minus 3. Okay. So this is the pole zero plot, you got that. So first point is clear. Now you have to write the transfer function. So let's do that. Transfer function is equal to numerator by denominator. Numerator is 0, denominator is poles. This is just for the understanding. So let's write the transfer function. It would be s minus z1 upon s minus p1 into s minus p2. Now z1, that is the 0, is given as minus 1. So it would be plus 1. And the pole 1 is given as minus 2 or minus 3. You can take anything. So it would be s plus 3, then s plus 2. So this is the transfer function of this system. Now tell me whether this system is stable or not. Comment the answer. I will tell whether it is correct or not.
तो फ्रेंड्स, अगर आपको मेरी वीडियो पसंद आ रही हो देन टू लाइक दिस वीडियो, शेयर विथ योर फ्रेंड्स एंड सब्सक्राइब टू माई यूट्यूब चैनल. तो मिलते हैं अगली वीडियो में. टिल देन टेक केयर. दिस इज श्रेनिक जैन. पीस आउट.